All right, David, thank you very much for the introduction. So today I will present on behalf of Genevieve Krombach. She will defend her PhD thesis in October, and she just started with the training as a radiologist. So recently we have shown, together with our international collaborators, that intraplaque hemorrhage is a strong independent predictor for ischemic stroke. So in this study, individual patient-based data were used for this meta-analysis, and you can see that there is a tremendous increase of stroke risk in patients with intraplaque hemorrhage on carotid MRI. However, it is still incompletely understood how intraplaque hemorrhage develops. So it's often thought that if you have inflammation within the thickened vessel wall, that this leads to hypoxia because of the high oxygen consumption by the macrophages. And this is known to induce angiogenesis. And the leaky plaque microvasculature is thought to be a port of entry for retocytes, which could lead to intraplaque hemorrhage and subsequently plaque destabilization, and may eventually lead to ischemic stroke. However, we have also in Maastricht, we did dynamic contrast enhanced MR imaging in combination with pharmacokinetic modeling to study plaque microvasculature non-invasively. And we compared K-trans, which is indicated for microvascular density, as well as leakiness in the plaques, with intraplaque hemorrhage and without. And we found, actually lower K-trans in plaques with intraplaque hemorrhage, suggesting there may be less leaky microvessels in these plaques. And we think this may be related to necrosis in these lesions. And in addition, we did another study together with the University of Washington group and with the University of Amsterdam. And in this study, we found that intraplaque hemorrhage often occurs at fissures in the fibrous cap at sites of increased biomechanical stress. So we hypothesized that the development of intraplaque hemorrhage is also affected by biomechanical and hemodynamical variables. And since it's known that the biomechanical load and wall shear stress are actually the highest in the proximal region of the plaque, we aim to study non-invasively whether there is a difference in volume of intraplaque hemorrhage at the proximal versus the distal region of the plaque. For our study, we included symptomatic patients that suffered from a TIA or minor stroke with a carotid plaque of at least 2 millimeters and less than 70% carotid stenosis from the plaque at risk study. And in all patients, multi-sequence carotid MRI was performed within 3 months after the clinical symptoms. And the plaque components were delineated by trained readers. And we defined the proximal region as the region proximal to the slice with the smallest luminal area. And then we studied potential differences in volume of intraplaque hemorrhage, but also fibrous cap status in the proximal versus the distal region. And so here I have an example of our MR images. We compare the pre- and the post-contrast images to look at the presence of a lipid-rich core, which hardly enhances, and the fibrous cap status. So the fibrous cap status is scored as thick when you have enhancement at the luminal site. So when there's no enhancement, it is scored as thin or ruptured. And we look on MP-RAGE, also known as inversion recovery T1-weighted TV images, hyperintense signal, and that is indicated for intraplaque hemorrhage. And so then all the components are delineated in dedicated software. So in our 224 patients of the PARISC study, 88 patients demonstrated ipsilateral intraplaque hemorrhage. So these patients could be used for the present analysis. And here I've shown the clinical characteristics of these patients. So they have the common cardiovascular risk factors. So here you see the data of the interplaque hemorrhage as a function of the slice position. So the zero slice is the slice with the narrowest lumen. And then here we have the proximal and the distal region. And it's very clear that the volume of intraplaque hemorrhage is actually much larger at the proximal side. And a similar effect was observed for a thin or ruptured fibrous cap. So again, we have here the zero slice with the smallest luminal area. And you see that the prevalence of a thin or ruptured fibrous cap is approximately 35% at the proximal side, while it's much lower, so less than 25% at the distal side. So concluding, the prevalence of intraplaque hemorrhage and thin or ruptured fibrous caps are more prevalent on the proximal side of the plaque. So this indicates that wall stress or wall shear stress may play an important role in the development of intraplaque hemorrhage. So unfortunately, in our study, we did not include any biomechanical measures yet. So this is something that needs to be investigated in future studies. So last but not least, of course, I would like to thank all my collaborators, and I would like to thank you for your attention.